Welcome back, everybody, here to the coverage of the Gigabyte Challenge. It is our third game of the night for day number one of our Gigabyte Challenge number. I don't know how many. Are we up to 11 now or something?
We're definitely in the double digits. I'm not sure exactly how far, but it's been a long time running thing.
We have the one and we have the O. That's what we're up to. Potentially, next time, lose some weight, and we have one and a one.
Yeah, we'll be number 11 together. Right. We do, since we have been doing this for so long, we should probably take the opportunity to thank Gigabyte for putting on this tournament for so long. As you guys can tell, I think the last two games that we had really showed off the strengths of the Gigabyte Challenge, which is being able to get some of these Tier 2, Tier 3 teams and completely unknown teams rising through the ranks and really be able to have the opportunity to win some money for themselves.
And everybody has big tournaments. At home can play
exactly
and win.
So the best way to be able to thank Gigabyte would be to talk about some of the other things that they do with Join Dota. If you go to our website, joindota.com, you'll notice that we actually have our own currency. It's called cheese, and it's not just completely fake pseudo currency that we have for absolutely nothing. Those leaderboards actually mean a lot. We have something called the Gigabyte Challenge Betting King, and basically, if you use our fake currency to bet on matches like these matches in the Gigabyte Challenge, you can go ahead and win yourself a whole bunch of cheese. And if you're top of the leaderboard at the end of the month, you actually win one of these bad boys. It is a Gigabyte Z97X Gaming 3. It is an excellent motherboard. It's got a whole bunch of fantastic features, such as supports 4th and 5th generation Intel Core processors. It's got an audio noise guard with LED path lighting. It's got a killer E2200 gaming network platform and a bunch of other great features that you could see at joindota.com. So as you can see, looks pretty badass.
I'm hoping it didn't break because this is the actual one we will send out to you.
Yeah.
I tried to be like the whole...
If you win the Gigabyte Challenge Betting King and it doesn't work, we'll flame Toby and we'll send you a new one. Making promises I don't think I can keep. But let's go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jump into game number three.
We'll have an entire news crew come and knock on. You know how they do that kind of thing with like the surprise TV shows? Just knock on your door. You've just won $1 million. Here's the cameras, everything else. Let's talk to your family. We'll be invading your house the next hour to create TV content.
Yep.
If you're in
we're not doing that.
If you're in Berlin...
We're not going to bring this to your door.
If you're in Berlin, then maybe we could do that. So if you're a winner and you're from Berlin, then we could...
I would appreciate that.
Yeah, we can probably do that. But only if you're in Berlin. Mm-hmm. And that's the east part of Berlin. We're not traveling to the west part of Berlin.
Yeah, that's too far away.
It's just like, one-hour train ride? Come on! There's some things we are willing to do. And some things which I think we'll be willing to do. Meanwhile...
Game number three, back at the
game of Dota, is
it's rare to say this in the Gigabyte Challenge, but in round number one of the Gigabyte Challenge, we have two known teams facing each other, Album Sheet and House of Gamer. Sure, they're not alliance level teams. Not everybody knows them in the Dota 2 scene, but if you follow a lot
of
matches, if you follow a lot of competitive Dota, you should recognize both of these names. At the very least, you should recognize some of the names. For example, Album Sheep has Big Numb on him, as well as Afterlife. Those two names have been around for quite some time. They're really good Russian team that have actually been providing a lot of upsets lately. Really been active, especially in Star Ladder. They provided a number of upsets there. House of Gamers, meanwhile, is a name that you maybe recognize a little bit less. But there is one name above all the others you should definitely recognize, which is Excalibur. He's going to be playing with House of Gamers.
He was voted as our it was in the
newcomer
list. As one of the best newcomers of 2014, even though technically he hasn't played for 3 months.
Yeah, it's been a while.
4 months. He basically disappeared, and everyone's asking, where is Excalibur? And he's just like, I'm waiting for a good team to join, kind of thing, and don't want to go half-assed,
And when you're that young and you've already made a name for yourself as a Dota player, the world is kind of your oyster. You don't need to rush into a commitment. You can just sit back, wait for a good team to come along and offer you a full-time position. Meanwhile, he's got school and stuff to think about.
True.
He was 16.
He's young.
Yeah.
He's very, very young. He looks very, very young as well. Album should give him the respect band. So the fourth band will be the band against the Meepo, which is Excalibur. It's one of his signature ones. The other one was the Tinker, and both... Well, it's, the Meepo hasn't been nerfed, but the Tinker has been nerfed to crap with the way they changed the way he interacts with the Ancients now with the March of the Machines. So, yeah. Yeah, Excalibur's in the list. By the way, if you haven't done it yet, vote. Vote over on for our Joint Otter Awards for 2014. There's a big article over on joinotter.com. You can just look at the one article. That's actually cool because we put all of the voting into one article. If you don't want to go through all of them, if you want to read the extended reading, which we've been releasing for the last 6 or 7 days, you can also do that. They're actually linked in the big article, or you can just go back through our news history. I even made a Reddit post for everybody, which
that was really nice, honestly. The big article, I missed out on a couple of the ones I forgot to vote in.
Yeah.
So when I went back and I was like, oh hey, there's this big article, I just scroll right through and is I'm able to vote on everything.
Oh, there we go. So. Hey, I had time to make the Reddit post and put it up. I had no idea if it would be successful, but it appears it is successful. We have it on the front page, number 12 on the front page of Reddit. So shout out to all those guys out there that was also arguing in our comment section of JD about who should really be the best player and so on and so forth. So yeah, meanwhile, let's actually look at our draft, man, because we are getting ourselves fairly the way through it, and we've been kind of avoiding our draft until we got to the fourth pickup of almost every single game tonight.
Plus, I was a little bit distracted. I just learned that one of my best friends that I have out there is actually playing on playing in the Gigabyte Challenge.
Really?
He was like, "Why aren't you casting this?" I was like, "I didn't know." They're playing up against Complexity right now. It's a team called Black Sheep.
We wish him the best of luck.
Wish him the best
at
of
the
luck.
At the same time, I kind of want to see Complexity versus 4ASC as our last game of the night. So, best of luck to you. I hope you fight well.
he's like, you need to cast me, dude. And I was like, all right, just beat Complexity. All right, go for it, buddy.
Good luck with that. Good luck with that. Yeah. Then again, tonight's the night. I don't think can happen.
Is.
Everything is best of ones. But yeah, but we're getting our way through our band, through our pick phase now. So VS, Doom, Death Prophet, Earthshaker, large amount of team fight potential here from House of Gamers. The Death Prophet, a hero who keeps getting overlooked, but whenever she's picked up, just seems to be a huge powerhouse. While Album Sheet go with Brewmaster, one of the old favorite great heroes, but keeps finding his way into a ban pool in the first two. But he'll be picked up as the first one here from Album Sheet. Wish Dr. Wraith King, Sky Wrath Mage, a lot of single target control coming out from them. But I'm wondering if it's really going to be enough, especially when you have a Brewmaster going up against a Doombringer. If he gets doomed, what else is there really for the Album Sheet lineup? And if this is like an Invoker as the final selection, you get the EMP Tornado kind of stuff up. Again, I'm concerned for a Wraith King not buying either a Sol Ring or a Magic Wand.
That was just so stupid.
Like, again, it's an inside joke. It's not an inside joke. It's a joke for all those people out there that were tuning in last night to the Joint Otter Raid. So if you're a subscriber and a follower of the channel, well, if you're not, do it. And if you are, raise your Zoes. your Kappas.
That was just so
stupid. All your Kappas. You got a lot of Kappas in there.
Because what was it? I remember, like, even, like, a year and a half, 2 years ago, I was talking to Complexity, I think. I think it was TC that I was talking to. And it was, TC was like, yeah, the Wraith King is actually just fine. This is back when Quaswex Invoker was very popular. It was the most popular kind of Invoker. We didn't see Exor.
Right.
Uh-huh.
And he was like, Wraith King is actually just fine versus Invoker. You just need to have a magic wand. I don't think you even need to invest into a soul ring. And I was like, yeah, you know, you're kind of right. That, on the other side, though, that is not a hero. You could just go, but I have a soul ring. He burns through mana so quickly, it doesn't matter.
But, really?
They did not expect this one at all.
It makes no sense against this.
This big brood mother.
It makes no sense against the House of Gamers.
It makes some sense. Death Prophet is the only hero that is actually... Earthshaker's okay.
I look at it from this point of view. The Death Prophet is able to clean up the early pushes with Crypt Swarm. And, okay,
yeah,
maybe...
He's not going to be in the same lane as the Death Prophet.
He's not going to be in the same lane. Yeah, true. But if you're forced into an early engagement, you're able to deal with that. Any mage, once he picks up the Battle Fury, I know, again, we're having another circumstantial thing. It's just able to cleave through a lot of the Broodlings. And Earthshaker, he loves Broodlings when he's got an ultimate.
When he has an ultimate, yeah. I think the pressure of the Broodmother, though, I don't think you can really... The Earthshaker Fisher, maybe, is more of a factor, I would say, than the ultimate is right now, because I think that the biggest part of this is more the power of Brood's constant pressure he's going to be able to put on this defensive trail lane. I don't think they have enough power to deal with him. We'll see whether or not they can, but... The biggest problem is that just Dust is not very good at being able to deal with Broodmother, just because the way it interacts with webs, it's dumb. It needs to be fixed. But the problem is I think the Broodmother is going to be able to put so much pressure on that tri-lane, and he should be able to do pretty well. Look at the rest of the album sheet members, too. It's a very, very team fight oriented lineup. Like, they have a lot of fighting heroes. Brewmaster, Wraith King. These are heroes that should not be AFK farming for 20 minutes. They're going to be looking for fights nice and early. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised at all. Should 100% be guaranteed to see a Blink Dagger Wraith King this game. You like it?
I once caught a fiend this big!
I was thinking more, give me a big hug. But
it's like, I don't know why this is called Undershock, but I just like lean back, throw it back. Would be how I would do that one.
Oh, that's right. There's the Juggernaut one.
The Wasabi. The Wasabi.
Where he's up and flying up in the air.
I do like the...
Wasabi.
Of course, Excalibur's always going to get its I choose you! Like Meepo. Kind of thing done. All right, so let's look at our lanes. As everyone's rolling out into them now, we can check up towards the top lane. It's going to be a Doombringer offlane boots first. It's going to be Excalibur going in towards the middle lane. No, he's not. He was thinking about it. And now he's going to head down towards the bottom lane as the Anti-Mage and let Slash Strike take the Death Prophet in towards the mid. Supportman for a moment, and that's going to be Vengeful Spirit. And our last player is Faith in Strangers. Playing up this role of the Earthshaker. Afterlife, Broodmother offlane. Middle lane, under shock, will be the Brewmaster. That puts Invince... I always say his name wrong.
Oh.
Inquisitor.
Inquisitor, I think?
Is it Inquisitor?
I don't remember. It's been a while since I cast him. Like, you get corrected and you're like, oh, this is the way I say it now, and then you don't cast them for like 2 months, and then they show up again and you're like, ah, damn it, all the hell, how do I say his name?
I remember one of them, which is just like Tron. I remember Tron.
Oh, yeah, Tron.
Okay, I remember Tron. Yeah. It's like easy, just light bikes. Big Nom's going to be up here on the top lane with the Witch Doctors. That's the last combo, so it's Witch Doctor as well as Sky Wrath Mage together.
The battle begins. Yeah, honestly, sometimes I think I need to, you know, that little black book that I have, or big black book, rather.
Yes.
Sometimes I think I just need to write down these Russian names, and that way, when I go back to some of these tournaments and be like, oh, hey, it's that guy. How do I say it again?
Well, you should always, like, with the bigger tournaments, we definitely take time out to make sure we pronounce names properly. Sure. There's only one person which I cannot, and that's Reason.
Oh, yeah.
Because I'm always like, oh, it's Reason. I'm like, what the no, that's not how you're meant to pronounce it. And even then, I'm not even 100% certain Reason is the way you're meant to pronounce it. I always get it wrong. Anyway, Earthshaker's playing a solo offlaner now. So they've, again, switched up. So it's not the Doombringer up here. The Earthshaker's just babysitting the lane and taking up the farm while the Earthshaker grabbed a centaur from inside the jungle.
Earthshaker here to have a good time.
Hey, Earthshaker offlane isn't that bad. I remember when Cloud9 were here doing their training for TI4. Actually, I think it was for the TI qualifier. No, it was for TI4. For the main event itself, and they were talking about like, I think it was Bone 7 who was the one who was trying to convince him that Earthshaker offlane was 100% legit, and Koifa was always a massive fan of like the Earthshaker core as well. Mm-hmm. Of course, now, the Earthshaker core dates back 2 years to the fact when Dandy played at middle lane, building a Daedalus onto that damn bastard. He did so much damage, so much damage.
The nostalgia error with Toby Wan Kenobi.
I remember back,
old days.
Back in the days of Dota.
Back in the international. Back in my day.
I remember back when we used to have to pay for video casting. None of this damn homely doobly that they used to get here with video being paid. You get paid to stream a video now. Shit. Kids had to work.
Back when the numbers that we're getting now would have been huge for you, back then.
Hey, dude, I would be wetting my pants with the numbers I'd have now. Anyway, Facts.
So I don't think you should run an Earthshaker complete off lane. I like the way that they play this.
Undershock. Okay, there's not enough mana. There's not enough mana for another Crypt Swarm. But he's got his bottle coming in anyway, so he's fine.
Do you remember Slash Strike, by the way?
I do remember Slash Strike. I don't remember many details about Slash Strike, but I remember his name.
So Slash Strike is the guy who beat us in the Staff Cup. He was playing on the 2P team. Yeah, they totally cheated. Except we had Melk. But we didn't really have Melk, because he left. So they cheated.
Wow.
Anyway, they actually won the whole entire
thing. I'm sensing some bitterness here, Cap.
they won the whole entire thing. Slash Strike's a really good player. I play with him occasionally. He's one of those pub guys who's making that transition into competitive play, and he knows a lot about Dota 2 as well, obviously, because he writes for 2P. So, yeah, he's quite the good player.
They're coming in for Afterlife. The Sentry Ward's been dropped, so they've got to get this timing right, and he's smack bang on top of him. The fact that VS then attacked him as he walked through kind of reveals the fact that they do have vision there now. But Excalibur's really happy with this. Like, there's a Broodmother who's 5-for-2 up against a 19-for-3 anti-mage 3 minutes and 22 seconds in. I think he's very happy with the CS. Even though Wraith King is keeping up, we're 20-for-6, we just know that Nanny Mage can flash farm, where Wraith King kind of has to rely on this early Blink Dagger running around, making openings in other lanes for things to really work.
It's kind of awkward. I've watched Afterlife miss a couple of CS, and this early CS is incredibly important for a Broodmother, especially in this lane matchup. Soul Ring. The earlier you get your Soul Ring, the faster you're going to snowball, the better opportunity you're going to be able to have to get a pick off on one of those supports. That's the biggest thing, right? These supports can't do much about a Broodmother.
Yeah.
They throw down a counter ward, and there's a very minimal threat for now. But later on, once he starts getting out a whole bunch of spiders, those supports are actually more of a detriment than a benefit to the Animage.
Yes, you really can't, like without the Soul Ring, like you're always going to be with no mana, so you can't throw out any spawn spiderlings until you get that Soul Ring.
Exactly. That's why missing the CS early on, like, he could have a Soul Ring right now if he didn't miss that early CS, that early easy CS that he could have had. So, hopefully he doesn't miss it anymore. Hopefully he gets that Soul Ring in a short amount of time. He's very close to it now. He's on his way. One thing I want to go back to is the Earthshaker. I love the way they played this, because I don't think you should run an Earthshaker as a full offlaner. I do like the idea of them putting him in the offlane whenever the Doom needs to go jungle. For example, at the start, he wants to be able to have an early creep. Why not give the Earthshaker that space in the top lane to be able to get his early level 2? Potentially even early level 3.
Yeah.
And this can just kind of continue. Whenever the Doom feels like he's too threatened, he goes back into the jungle, and the Earthshaker goes up the top lane, throws down a Fissure Block, gets some ease.
They're going to go mid. He doesn't have enough damage for this, and there's not another Crypt Swarm again. But I'm actually kind of liking it for the transition of items as well for the Earthshaker. You give them the space to farm up. Does this mean then Blink Dagger, early Arcane Boots, things for other people to work them with? Yeah, that's cool. I like it. It's always good to give support space. Especially early on where Earthshaker, he went boots first anyway, so he would have already got the roaming around, so that's kind of okay. They just saw Big Num walk up. That's a kill. That's first blood right there. The Doom gonna turn on the Scorched Earth. He's got all the movement speed in the world, and then body blocked by an invisible force. He missed the War Stomp though! This won't work for him! He's waiting for him! He's waiting to actually throw out the extra Crypt Swarm and then the attack, and he'll get the timing right.
He almost screwed that one, though. There is no reason that he should have walked down that that staircase, right? It's a one-unit block area. Yeah. So the he just plants himself on that stairs, and they would have been able to trap him inside.
Brewmaster is going for the solo kill right now on the Death Prophet. There's TP support coming in, but from the Skyrath Mage, Flash Drive is going to cut his way through the tree line, forcing Undershock to take the damage. But remember, Undershock has still got his ultimate split available, but he won't require it. Not with a haste rune like that. So he'll get a solo kill on the Death Prophet. So even though First Blood does go the way of Hog, it's not really going to give any kind of bonus to them anymore. Not with that solo kill on the Death Prophet.
Yep. And that's the moment you're like, team, help. Help me. He did a really good job juking that around for a while, but unfortunately his team was like, the Earthshaker didn't have a TP scroll, and then the Vengeful Spirit did have a TP scroll, but didn't have mana. To be able to TP and be able to get a magic missile stun. So there was no way his supports could help him in that scenario. Plus, they've got their hands full right now dealing with this Broodmother.
Yeah. Excalibur is like trying to have as much help as he can get from a moment. A moment keeps on letting off this wave of terror. dropping these spirelings by 4 armor. So they are a little bit easier to kill off for the animage who doesn't have a damage dealing item. Because he's still just poor man shield as well as the ring of health. There's still a lot of chip damage coming into him all the time. But until he gets something like...
throw the spiderlings at a moment. If he actually split the spiderlings up... No, he's got this kill. Never mind.
Yeah, he does.
Easy. This is why I loved the Broodmother pickup so much, is that you're right. There is going to be ways that Hog can deal with the Broodmother later on to the game, but I think just the laning presence, this part right here, is just going to cripple Hog so much.
He's just going to stop feeding into that animage, though. Because, sure, okay, he just killed off the Vengeful Spirit, but I'm still very concerned that this animage... hasn't been quelled. Like, he's just been able to move quite freely here, and now Afterlife, he's diving in deep. They bring dust? They didn't bring dust. And Slash Strike's now moving himself towards the bottom lane. They get the fissure off Afterlife. He's actually, you know, he's in range of his own web. There will be the silence over on Slash Strike, and we've already got faith in him. Okay, Slash Strike will have no faith in him anymore. He just turns for one Crypt Swarm, uses Stink Charge, trying to bait this fight out as long as he possibly can, but the orb, the bottle charge, he'll stay alive, but not long enough. The Broodmother now picks up his second kill underneath this tier 1 tower, and that's the second time the Death Prophet's died within the last 2 minutes.
Yeah, if you want to, if you're concerned about how many Spiderlings, and this is why I really want that stat for Valve to put out, of being able to tell how much gold you feed away with summon units.
Yep.
I think it's a really important thing, and we could actually get a lot of insight into the pros and cons of some of these heroes like Furion, Broodmother, and it used to always be
broken down in Warcraft 3. Like, you always had like you had it broken down between neutral kills, you had it broken down between lane creeps as well, and even like the amount of money which was spent on wards at every single game. Like, that was also available. There's really so many stats matchup wise which just are not available on the end stat screen, which could
but
be.
If you're concerned about that, look at the difference between net worth and the Wraith King and the Animage. Wraith King is ahead of the Animage right now, and then look at the difference between the Broodmother and the Doom, right? He is a full 1,000 gold ahead of that Doom, and is actually the Wraith King still ahead of the Animage, right? So he's not feeding a clear advantage to the Animage in any way, and he's also gaining a huge advantage over the other offlaners. So
can the Broodmother really stay in front, though? Like, if we take this to late game, and you're up against a Doombringer, Animage, as well as Death Prophet, can he really stay there? Okay, maybe...
No, you don't go late game with this team. You do not go late game with
so
this
are you happy with the Hand of Minus pickup as opposed to picking up something like an early Orchid?
I think it's fine, generally. I mean, levels are decently important on the Broodmother. And I think that's the biggest determination of a Hand of Minus is, one, how early can you get it? And two, how important are levels on your hero, not gold? There was actually a Reddit post a long time ago that pointed that out brilliantly by breaking down the stats of Hand of Minus. And the conclusion that the person drew from it was right in line with my own reasoning, which is, again, the gold doesn't necessarily matter so much from Hand of Minus. It's a lot of it comes down to the experience, and I think many people forget about that aspect of Hand of Minus.
Well, right now, Broodmother is almost there anyway, and he's looking at Excalibur, and there's jumping clap, Spidling, Excalibur! Hit. 30 life points, he needs to blink, 3 seconds, 2 seconds,
the movement speed,
he got one hit in, but he doesn't have bite, which means a blink away to safety.
Oh, he could still get him, he's gonna
actually,
go over
he does have bite, he has 1 point up in bite, Spidling, he's got him. And in fact, the Courier is still flying at Observer Wards here. Earthshaker wants to make his play up, he can let the fissure go, and Afterlife is currently between webs, but just plants a new one. He's away to safety. This Broodmother is crippling Hog.
Yep, Mother comes and she's wrecking House of Gamers right now.
And I really, like...
You sound so distraught, Toby. Is it Broodmother coming back into the meta that is disturbing you?
That's literally it, Cap.
It's like, man, Broodmother's back and I don't like it at all.
If people remember, like, we talked about SK Gaming earlier tonight, but remember when Link was still playing for SK Gaming with Ryze and Angel and all those guys together? And it was Prophet, it was Broodmother, it was Spectre, it was everything which would never have to fight.
And dying was pretty popular back then as well.
Yeah, because it was just, it would force everything.
He would be run right alongside of the Death Prophet.
But what the Broodmother did was it forced out the situations like we saw at TI3. We actually got some problems with the Brewmaster who's now doomed up. He'll die in the middle lane. Yeah, but what the Broodmother basically does, and you're seeing it from Afterlife right now, like, PO was nerfed, so this kind of stuff could not happen. So all you do is you take out this bottom tower, you can control this entire area, and you're farming it up while you're pushing the bottom lane, and you're capable of farming then all the neutral resources, everything on the lane, and you're forcing towers as well, and you never put yourself in jeopardy. Because the Broodmother is able to freely walk around. In fact, she's more powerful now because she walked through the trees. All she's got to do is just get her timing right. And just forces every single area of the entire southern or northern part of the map, depending if you're on Radiant or Dire. And what can you really do about it? You want to actively move in there to gank her. That's taking four heroes out to try and gank her up, which is when every other core, every other support hero can freely move, knowing they will have a hero advantage in every fight that they take. And now they're taking another one over on the Doombringer. He is toast right now. And there's nothing they can do about it. Now, in fact, because they have one hero down, they can't go gank the Broodmother. They can't fight in the middle lane. Because if they find the middle lane, they lose the fight. If they try and go down and stop the Broodmother, they'll lose their other towers, or they'll lose another hero who's in the wrong position. And now the Broodmother is in so deep, she can even farm because she can walk over cliff lines.
Yep, this is what I was talking about earlier when you brought
up late game. God, it's disgusting!
When you brought up late game, Toby, is that this lineup is not meant to go late. It's meant to win the game, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that is the big weakness of a Broodmother. We're going to see a Wraith King. He doesn't have mana because he doesn't have a magic wand.
Oh, the cask?
Yeah, it'll bounce up. The Death Prophet will actually get this kill, in fact, with this Crypt Swarm and Excalibur, letting off the Mana Void. But now in comes Broodmaster. He's even got a crit on the animator. She blinks up and just TPs away to safety. Finishes the Battle Fury. 13 minutes in, which is nice for him. There's no stun available. And Undertruck will just have to walk himself away to safety. So that's some nice pickoffs there. Yeah, it's just a disgusting hero, but Broodmother in the later portion of the game really kind of drops off if the split push doesn't keep working.
Oh, for sure. Broodmother is not a very strong hero in the late game at all. At the best thing she possibly is a decent anti-carry, which is a term I occasionally bring up. She's not necessarily good at being able to kill a bunch of the enemy team, but she is kind of good at just being able to lock down a carry very well through the lifesteal, the miss percentage chance, and possibly the Orchid doing some work as well.
Witch Doctor's dead.
Which Orchid is up now.
Witch Doctor should really be dead now. Wave of Terror, reveal it. Whoa, they need to see him. He's in the corner. He can waste the ultimate. No, it won't happen. Death Prophet will take a kill. In the meantime, Earthshaker ends up dying again to, would you believe, a Broodmother. And there's a chase coming out from Skywrath Mage searching for Excalibur. So, Seal. And now in comes the Hellfire Blast as well. There's no Mystic Flare available, so he'll jump up. The burn isn't actually affecting him anymore. And he's able to get himself away to safety while Fortification has to protect that Tier 1 tower in the top lane from Slash Strike.
Another close one. You notice something, though? This Broodmother did so well in the laning phase that he is going to have an Orchid that is effective versus the Animage for probably 10 minutes.
He got it at the same time, man. Like, if he just went for a straight Orchid and had a rough lane on the off lane, he's still got the Orchid at the same time. But because he's got Midas, he's up to level 13 and a half. Okay, assuming warding trip? No. Yeah. Nope, just assuming death. But he's so far ahead and continuously moving further ahead because he just can farm everything. He's got 97 CS in a very short period of time. The only person who's beating him is actually, there's two, Wraith King as well as Animage, but he's on par with them as well.
Yeah, normally Broodmother is not very good against natural Manta or BKB buyers, but in this case, she's just so far ahead and the Animage is somewhat shut down that you'll have an Orchid effective timing of about 10 minutes, I would say. Excalibur, I don't think he's going to have a Manta for another until like 25 minutes.
He only just finished his treads.
Yeah, exactly. So he's going to have a rough time trying to get there, which means he pretty much, like, the bottom half of the map is closed off to him. Like, his jungle, denied. Nothing he can get out of that.
So how is he meant to farm?
He has to go top. Exactly what he's been doing.
Then how is the rest of his team meant to farm?
He's been going in adventures into the enemy jungle and almost dying there, you know? It's because it's his only option. And Album Sheet, they're probably a very smart team. From what I've seen from them, they seem to be pretty strategic-minded. They are going to do two things during this time. One, they're going to really abuse the fact that House of Gamers have to put multiple heroes in the top lane. So you do things like Roshan, you take over the enemy jungle, you push down the bottom tier 2 and the middle tier 2. Make sure you don't get caught.
They can't initiate on him. He's got blade mail.
That's true.
Like, if they try and fight him, he'll do so much damage to them, then respawn up. But he doesn't care about dying right now. He's got a level 2 reincarnation because this Wraith King has space with a hand of Maya. So 17 minutes in, he's hit level 11. So and they're moving over for a kill here, and with a Brewmaster of Varble, Claps slows up Excalibur, he needs a crit, and he got both of them got a crit. Now they have no extra stun, it's 2 seconds on cooldown, so Slash Strike will get himself away to safety. But that's a big kill because one, the Animage dies, sets him back in his farm, but two, he's not farming right now.
So they did smart thing number one, which was take Roshan, abuse the bottom half of the map being empty, and smart thing number two would be to put their four members of Album Sheet at the top lane while Broodmother goes bottom.
Yule Scepter.
Because look at their team. They're a team that can fight 4 versus 5. That's the beauty of their lineup. Wraith King, very aggressive carry. Brewmaster, the ultimate team fight winner at this point in time. So they can go ahead and put four heroes top and put pressure there and take down that tier two. And if House of Gamers want to respond with a full five, Album Sheet could still win that. Plus, they're coming in tier two bottom.
Orchid on Doom, which means that means there is no silence to actually stop the split apart from the one from Death Prophet. But it's already too late. If they initiate on this, Brewmaster, he just does this. Split itself up. There's already the silence over from the VS. So there's no follow-up stun from him. Mystic Flare ensures the kill. But it's in fact the Brewmaster that gets the kill. And that's a tier two tower in the bottom lane, which I believe is in fact forfeit. The creep wave will come in and they can't come close on this, because the second they do, they know they'll die, and Broodmother straight back to farming. Even Witch Doctor's got space in the middle lane to add more pressure. And they fortify just to protect the tier 2 tower. Now remember, they weren't able to fortify again. All their tier 1 towers are down, so there's no refresh on it. They're onto the normal countdown timer now. And there goes tower. Failed on the last hit, the Broodmaster. But at this point, I don't think they care. They got so much money coming in. There's 2.4k gold over on the Broodmother now. And the Brewmaster even just handed a Vladimir's aura to his team when they push.
Yeah, this Broodmother is big. And she, when she's this far ahead, like any hero that's this far ahead, is still going to have a very big impact in team fights. So
yeah,
even though it is like, oh, it's a Broodmother, she's not really that good at team fights. Well, when you're, you know, 3,000 gold ahead of the top farmer of HOG, yeah, you're still going to have a very big impact.
So I'm checking my side screen. Animage goes down again. Afterlife managed to get himself stuck inside the trees for the moment. Has to wait out the time before he can start walking again. Ah, he's good now.
Yeah, the silence coming out from... He needs that Manta so, so badly.
Oh, Doombringer.
But the Broodmother wrecked their lane hard enough that he wasn't going to be able to get a 20-minute Manta. And now he's so susceptible to the Orchid, to the Skywrath Mage silence. Radiance. Hell, even to the Wraithfire Blast, just being able to have that instant disjoint is very big, but it's only once you get the Manta, and he's just not going to be able to get there in time. In fact, he's delaying it for going for a Vlad's. I'm not sure if I agree with that in general.
Hang on, who? What? Animages?
Our Animage is going for a Vladimir. So I'm not sure. The idea being that, okay, I need to go and like jungle and do things like that. He needs to be able to farm up Ancients.
He needs to fight. Like, if they can give him enough space after he picks up the Vlads that he can start farming, then yeah. I'm okay with this. But I don't think he's going to get the space to then work his way into a BKB.
Yeah.
Like, until he gets that, it's just not going to happen.
Vladimir's is typically an item on Animage, which is you would go instead of the Battle Fury. And it's because, oh, my lane is so difficult, I have to go jungle full time sort of thing. Well, these stools are gone comfortable.
Kind of looks like a freaking ballerina right now in the studio. Balancing half on the desk. They're moving up towards the top lane now. There's 3 Radiant heroes up here. Wraith King would just love to jump in and initiate wherever he can. But he's going to be careful about mana still. We still have to remember there is no Sol Ring. There is no magic wand. It's happening twice in 2 nights. And they're going to TP more in. Stun, silence, vengeful spirit. He's dead. Absolutely toast. The Animage will try and blink himself away. Doombringer will TP himself out to safety. Was able to be on the right side of the tree line, or in fact, this time the south side of the tree line. But what's really happened here? So the VS has died. You didn't push out the tier 2 tower. Sure, the tier 1 tower in the top lane is gone, but the Broodmother is still pushing and farming bottom lane. And he's looking at an opening. He's like, well, okay, We've basically
got the Doom, though.
I don't know if that's
good counter gank.
Is it going to be enough? Is it going to be enough? Because he's just going to outrun him. Excalibur, the Echo Slam Fission, now it's enough. They finally end the Broodmother.
Very, very good counter gank. That was well played. Blink Dagger picked up on the Doom, and they immediately take advantage of it by ganking the Broodmother like that. Well done.
I managed to get almost 2.3k experience just from that kill.
It's the little things.
Well, in this case, it's a big thing. Like, just the relief of pressure. Look how fast Excalibur moved down
Excalibur's
south.
Excalibur's like, oh, my jungle. It's been so long.
And then jungle taken away from them. The Doombringer goes down. The double blink boys just brawling it up. You should actually say the double blink crit boys.
Yeah, I was about to say double blink, double crit. It's
that's amazing
double
how
trouble.
Quick you pick off.
Double trouble.
But at least the enemy mage now is walking around 1,500 gold. He's still behind that of the three cores of AS, but it could be a hell of a lot worse for them. Like, a lot worse. Yeah. Is that Earthshaker? Yeah, he has Blink. Which means when AS try and push high ground, it's not going to be really as easy for them to get up.
They're very nicely played. Considering how badly... He's gotten a lot of Spiderling kills.
Yeah.
That's why he's at 75 CS, so it makes sense that he's been able to...
They have to jump quick on this one. He's got Nimviz rune. I don't see this working. Yule Scepter up. They're going to get instant silence. Remember, he's got that Invis. He can't trigger it in time. The AM ultimate, and there goes the Invis rune, but he still dies. So he blows the Invis rune that was inside the bottle. I don't know if that actually automatically activated or something.
They still had to dust anyway, so...
Either way, they've got to push for this tier 1 tower quickly, but the Exorcism won't last long enough. They're trying. Excalibur can at least mop up the creep wave nice and quickly, but they'll have to TP back instantly because the Broodmother is just going to start creep skipping it.
Mother comes. She's going to go for that middle tier 2.
It's a Manta choice from Excalibur. He is going for the Manta.
Oh, yeah, there is literally no other option.
You could go straight into the BKB.
No, I don't think.
Oh, Doom top lane. They're looking for the Wraith King. He's got Reincarnation. They need the Anti-Mage here. And he's TPing in. Excalibur, burn. You're going to get low enough below 160. You got him below 160. They actually stopped attacking him to make sure that he wouldn't actually kill him as he was burning the mana then.
Yeah, very well played.
Death Prophet's dead, though.
Well, she does have a Yule Scepter, so the Orchid's not going
to
work.
It's the double TP support that came to the T1 tower. Afterlife just needs to wait.
He saw the rotation over.
The Observer wants to watch them closely. Afterlife, he just Yule Scepters the Broodmother instead and walks away. And he will have his BKB now completed. Or practically completed.
8 to 14, 25 minutes in. Honestly, House of Gamers have a pretty good shot at being able to win this game. It's despite the fact that Album Sheet were able to crush all the way up until like the 15-minute mark, they've kind of stalled out in the last 10 minutes.
They haven't gotten high ground yet.
Yeah.
But you can't blame them. Like, even just looking at the Earthshaker with the Blink Dagger is enough to scare you out. But the only other option then is to split push this. Like, you just have to keep the Broodmother forcing at the bottom lane and have the other four go around smoke ganking, doing whatever they can, allow the Broodmother to do chip damage towards the bottom and potentially just finish out these outer towers of Hog.
Yeah, for me, it's less about the damage that they put into the Tier 3 tower and the fact that Broodmother hasn't been able to claim anything. He hasn't even touched the Tier 3 tower yet. That is not that big of a deal for me because I look at the House of Gamers lineup, and as you were saying, early on into the draft, they do have ways to be able to stop that. That's fine. It's more the fact that Album Sheet haven't taken the rest of the Tier 2s that they should be able to with their 4-man lineup. They just need to split attention. While there's one or two heroes dealing with the Broodmother, you just 4-man into a tier 2 at the top lane. And they either, House of Gamers either try and defend it with minimal or even numbers, which they should lose that fight, or they commit 5 heroes to stopping you at the top lane, and Broodmother takes a tier 3. Like, it's just a trade-off, and I don't see Album Sheet actually executing that. Yeah, this is a failure of strategy rather than individual play. They do at least take Roshan again. Good awareness there. And ooh, what? I love it.
Scythe of Ice over on the Wraith King.
Yeah, that's tight. I like that. I mean, hey, it gives him a gigantic mana pool now, right? So it's possible he's going to be able to get Reincarnation off. It also means that he has a Blink instant stun on the Animage, which means even once you do have Manta, you can still be caught out, Scythe of Ice, Chain Stun down.
Mm-hmm. Do you actually think it's for him? Do you think it's for him? Because I'm wondering right now if it should actually be for the Doombringer.
Because I know for whoever you catch, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just a pick-off in general. Nice pick-off on the Doom.
Oh.
Everybody else gets out, though.
Well, they used the Bruce Split for that one, too.
All right.
I was watching the middle lane, which is for this kind of stuff. Slash Strike. He got the Hex on the Death Prophet. The BKB is still available there. He'll get stunned up. Decided not to use the Yule Scepter, and now we'll pay the price for it. So much damage into him. The Orca going into the Earthshaker. He can't jump. Obviously, he's being attacked. And the BKB from Afterlife will protect him. Another Hellfire Blast. The Scarif Mage gets the kill. But it was the crit that came out from the Wraith King, which really put him into that critical range. That's a 10-second BKB down. They still have Orc at the Manta. Completed now for Excalibur, but he's walking outside of his base before he healed up. He needs more life points before he can come and fight this one. He doesn't have Doom. He doesn't have his Earthshaker. The buybacks, they're not available. It's only the Doom and the Death Prophet which have buyback available. And with no fortification, the Tier 3 tower is toast. Doom is up, but they still need the Earthshaker. Or else they don't really have that big jump in fight. And now Yule Scepter will be used on the Broodmother. Just running himself away. They don't care if this Brood dies because he still has the Aegis of the Immortal. If they can get a couple of kills for that, they're okay for that.
Move your Spiderlings out. Come on. There's been a lot of Mismicro and Spiderlings here. He's fed too many. The point of the Broodmother here, and why it was such a strong pick, it was the lane presence, the pressure he was going to be able to put on, not pushing down a Rax. Like, you shouldn't try and do that because you're just going to feed a whole bunch of gold to the enemy team. So he keeps on doing that. He keeps feeding away Spiderlings. He's Mismicroing a lot, and it's feeding a lot of gold into the Earthshaker as well as the Death Prophet. It's why we had the Earthshaker was able to pick up such an early Blink Dagger. So he's still more of a benefit than he is a detriment, for sure. But, you know, he's kind of lessening the advantage that he got so early by continually feeding the enemy team.
I can understand your point, man. Right now, they're right underneath the sentry wall. They know how many Spiderlings are just sitting on this bottom lane. Unfortunately, right now, the Earthshaker is in the wrong position. He has to TP himself down. He still sees that wonderful ping, like, and the ping comes out of the Spiderlings, but they've shifted themselves towards the mid lane now. So the Spiderlings can keep their pressure on the bottom, but they're coming in for the range racks. Afterlife's the one to the front lines, the fortification will trigger. Animage is still pushing that tier 2 tower up on the top lane. But it's the mid tower which is still being worked out. Swap is potentially there to bring down the Broodmother. It's only the range rakes from now, so they don't really care much more about that, but the Broodmother jumps in, he gets a split off. The stun was also wasted there from the Vengeful Spirit, and Doom never got his ulti off. VS with a swap out will keep the Doombringer alive, but these Broodlings are actually dying. There's only two of them left right now. Excalibur, oh, okay, he's dying faster. The Spiderlings into him, but when he got stunned up and then got Mystic Flare down, Excalibur had no real way to survive that. Undershock's back to his normal self with the end of the DD rune. And the Exorcism is about to wear off. They'll just come back high ground again with no anti-mage. He's short of his buyback by 30 gold. And I think he just bought a TP scroll. Yeah, he just bought a TP scroll, so he's actually now 130 gold away from buyback. Not that certain about that.
I think he's just determined, I am not buying back. I don't really care.
Failed! The BKB came up from the Broodmother! Now the Wish Doctor Aghanim's ult, he's bouncing out some extra damage. That just did absolutely nothing, the ultimate. It split them perfectly, but the bad type of perfectly.
I think Excalibur was kind of saying, hey guys, don't try and defend that necessarily. If you see a good opportunity to go for it, but I am not going to buy back. We all know we're going to lose a lane of Rax. We're going up against a Broodmother. It's not that big of a deal.
Yeah. Cool, Afterlife. But I guess it's not going to trigger on him. You know, get himself away to safety. The top lane is still pushing it nicely, and maybe AS will just decide to just fall back to that top tower.
So it looks like they're going to be heading back. Gives me the opportunity to talk about the side device. So I saw a lot of people in the chat arguing over it. I think there are a lot of points that are missed here. So first of all, the Scythe of Ice is going to give you the most, the largest increase in mana pool out of any other item that you could have. So when you talk about other items, like Orchid was discussed, not going to give you the same amount of mana pool. Mana pool is the most important thing for the Wraith King. He doesn't care about mana regeneration. He needs raw mana to make sure that he still has mana left when he dies. And that may not happen, right? He may get burnt out before and still die to the enemy. That's not that big of a deal. The sight device is also a hard disable. So it's not a soft disable like the silence from Orchid. It's a hard disable, able to lock down. So you can blink in and instantly get that stun onto the enemy, lock him down, get the following chain stuns. Because the biggest thing about the Manta is that not only is it a really good item for enemy in general, right, it's just naturally you're always going to go a Manta because of that burn. But yep. It also deals with the Orchid, and it disjoints a lot of what Album Sheet are throwing at him. The silence from the Skywrath Mage, the silence from the Orchid, the Wraithfire Blast, the cast, like all these things you're going to be able to deal with somewhat with a correct Manta timing. So the Manta is exceptionally good against all of that, but it's no good versus a instant lockdown like Scythe of Ice. So this actually means the Wraith King is a solid disabler up against the Animage, and it means the Animage has to play a lot more careful when going for Split Push, which is your only way right now House of Gamers have to stop Album Sheet from just taking your base. They can't actually win teamfights. Album Sheet have the better teamfight crew right now. Even with a Broodmother joining them, who is not a terribly good teamfight hero, they still completely have better teamfight due to the Brewmaster, plus just, I mean, Witch Doctor having Ags, having a gold advantage, all these sorts of things. So the only way they really have is just Split Push.
Environment might be really regretting the fact he came up here to defend the tower. They start with the Hex over on Slash Strike, and now Witch Doctor! That's a big ultimate! The Mana Void will end up cancelling it out, but the damage was already done to him. The Doombringer dropping very, very quick. Slash Strike will let the ulti off, but we've still got Reincarnation available. Witch Doctor dies on the sidelines to Excalibur. He moves forward again, jumps up, the stun trying to keep Slash Strike away. The Mystic Flare keeping Excalibur out too, but then Reincarnation up. He returns to the world of the living, silence up very quickly, so no help by a blast yet, but gets the crit in Excalibur, forced away to blink himself away while Radiant's Courier somehow is in the middle of that fight. Excalibur, is there another crit? There doesn't even need to be. Two swings is enough damage, while on the bottom lane, the Broodmother just took out the Melee Rax. Looking towards the range, the Yule Scepter up, four heroes to try and kill off Afterlife. Excalibur comes in to try and do the work as well. He will drop, but he still took Melee Rax, and they'll take the Tier 2 tower in the top lane with an Animage buying back. The Range Rax has 20 life points. It is gone. Yeah. Is there a spider? Just one could bring that down right now.
Yeah, just throw some spiders at it eventually, and they'll be able to get it. So T-Rax down now. House of Gamers, they don't even... They do have better late game, but when you're T-Rax down, they don't have... Like, you need a Medusa at this point if you're going to be T-Rax down. So I think this game is kind of over for House of Gamers. I don't really think there's a comeback way back into this game. They do have better late game, for sure. But it's just more of a problem of simple numbers and strategy.
Yeah.
Album Sheet just like split push the bottom lane, throw the rest of the heroes at the top lane. Eventually, something's going to connect. Eventually, they will either win a team fight or at least do enough damage to finish off and get mega creeps.
Mm-hmm. I think so. The last thing they'll wait for, though, is 2.5 minutes until Roshan's up and running.
Yeah,
so once,
sure.
Once they have the big man, once they have the Aegis, this will be the third Roshan as well. So it should be Aegis and Cheese coming their way. It's almost impossible to stop them. You've got Shiva's Guard over on the... Over on the Brewmaster, you got an Assault Cuirass, which is also over on the Broodmother. And then you've also got an Abyssal Blade almost completed over on the Raid King. So you got another lockdown controller coming your way, even with a BKB. And in fact, oh wow, oh wow! Oh, that's just cruel! That's just cruel! He used the creep to make sure the paralyzing castle was going to keep him there, and then just threw the ulti down. Knew the damage would be more than enough. And the Doombringer gets picked off solo by a Witch Doctor who wasn't even down on the same level as him. He was a whole different level.
A whole nother level. Good pick off by the Witch Doctor. Now Album Sheet. Just, like you said, sit back, wait for Roshan. Farm up. They can get an Abyssal Blade on the Wraith King. That'll be another hard disable that they'll have versus the Animage or Doom or Death Prophet. I mean, any of these heroes are actually quite good of initiating on. Right, you catch out the Doom and burst him down before he gets off his ultimate. Big win for you. Same goes with the Death Prophet and obviously the Animage. You always want to try and get a pick off on him. So the hard disables that they're getting. In fact, I would love to be able to see Afterlife. Looks like he's going to be going for the butterfly route, but I would have loved to see a basher on him by now.
I think at this point he just wants to be out of man fight up against the Animage.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense.
Because where else? Like, the only other physical damage you're looking at is coming out from the Death Prophet.
I mean, how do you hit... You can't hit the Broodmother. Like, you almost have 100% miss rate when you're dealing with a butterfly and you have an incapacitating bite on you.
Oh, BKB. He orchids over on the Earthshaker. There's no Echo Slam damage. Swap him away. Is there another spawn spilings? Not while he's actually now doomed, silenced up. Runs away. Can't get the tree line. Five heroes chasing the Broodmother up. So he will end up going down, but Roshan... It's the mag spawn timer, man. Like, it's off by like maybe 5 seconds or something like that. And then it's just like, come on! Come on!
Yeah, you would criticize in that situation the Broodmother for being too far forward because, yeah, they committed 5 heroes to kill the Broodmother, but Album Sheet didn't get anything in return. The only reason they didn't get anything
in return,
though,
is
the max Roshan time.
Hog's gonna get there in time. The Brewmaster's really not sure about this. Jumps out, claps, goes for the split. The Wish Doctor ulti. Now there's no bounce damage out for it again because it's already killed the VS. But up goes the Death Prophet. He's still only got his own Yule Scepter and BKB. Please put him down! Finally, but he's going to just TP himself away to safety. Okay, bit of a...
I think his Storm Panda was kind of out of range. That's the issue. It was blocked out by the Fissure, so he was having issues microing it close enough.
But this now means like you got Brewmaster ulti down, Wish Doctor ulti down. You can still take out Roshan, but Pignum is the safety net right now.
Right.
Are they actually
make a shadow amulet? Boys. That would be so legit.
I would like. How many can you do with that? Just like keep doing it, annoy your allies.
You could just keep doing it over and over again.
So you have like 4 of them invis waiting for Hulk just to walk into the pit and then
totally
boom.
Do that.
That would be the ultimate bait. The ultimate bait. So let everyone know as well, if you are tuning in for the Gigabyte Challenge and you've only just joined us, welcome to the coverage. We're here in our 3rd game with a knight. There will be the 4th game if everything goes as predictions would say. We will have Complexity going up against 4ASC. So the boys from America, the new Hon rejects, going up against the Finland boys. So that'll be coming up later on this evening, right after this game. We should be jumping into that one, so definitely stay tuned for that one after this match. And now it looks like AS has finally had enough of... they're not even doing the split push thing.
I'm not even sure why they're trying to do some weird two-man gank, but that's never going to work. And
They're going to lose one. Wraith King's already here. Starts with a Hex, gets the first crit as well into the Hellfire Blast. Didn't even need a second crit for it. The Doom is down for 60 seconds. Buyback is available for him, however. I don't think he really wants to use it at this point of the game.
Yeah.
But he's got no choice. If they push the tier 3 tower on the top lane, they just have no choice. And that's exactly where they're coming. He's going to have to buy back for this matchup. Not for this fight.
Alright. Force out the buyback on the Doom. They still have Reincarnation on the Wraith King. They still have the Aegis on the Broodmother.
And that cheese is on the Sky Wrath Mage.
Yeah, it's gonna be on this Earthshaker. Just keep your camera on Earthshaker and just if he makes a big Echo Slam play, maybe they can defend for a little bit.
Yeah,
longer,
but look how split up ASR. They got some guys over here, some guys over here. Your Earthshaker area is right here right now, and there's 3 units.
And only swap play a moment, thinking about it. Doesn't want to go on the Brewmaster for sure. But if he sees like the Witch Doctor, he'll do it.
He's gotta swap him deeper than that though. And they got to get the instant doom if it is going to be the Brewmaster. He jumps in, and there's the Brewmaster split. Into the Wish Doctor ulti. It's going to be canceled off by a very quick Mana Void and Slash Strike. That ult is going to do some work. He's got this BKB to protect him, but the Doombringer, he's already down again. The AoE is getting nuked down, but Excalibur refuses to die back to the base. The swaps, he's trying to also keep the Earthshaker away. Slash Strike ulti is still doing some work. Yule Scepter up in towards the air. The Brewmaster back to his normal self, which means he can clap him to death. The buyback will come up from both the ES as well as the Death Prophet. But they're beating down the towers. The middle lane is already starting to push in as well. And Excalibur searching for a kill on Bignum. He won't find its opening, however. And you've got Undershock just waiting for it to come in. There's your seal on Excalibur. Jumps in. The Trump roll him down. And it will be successful. I think this game is over, Cap. Good game. Well played. Comes out from Hog. Game was good. Game was golden. But game belongs to AS.
Well played by Album Sheet. I'm not surprised in any way. Like, I think a lot of people would, if you forced them to bet on this matchup and you said, hey, Excalibur's on House of Gamers, they would immediately go to bet on House of Gamers because of that fact. But Album Sheet is just a stronger team in general, and I think they've really proved that with all the games that they played. More like a month and a half ago was really where they were on quite a tear. So good on them. Looking forward to seeing them. I'm going to presume that they'll make it through round two without any issues, as they are...
they'll be going up against either Hellraisers or LC.
Ooh, Hellraisers, though. That's another team out of the CIS region. That region that is actually really good. Talking is hard sometimes.
English language.
Yeah. So Hellraisers versus Album Sheet, most likely. Wow, that's
yeah, look forward to that game. Matchup. You could also look forward to the semifinal, which is going to happen tomorrow. We've already got one of them, which came through our upper bracket. So DT going up against BBC were the victors for that last game in the quarterfinals over IDEC, which is the team which beat Moscow 5 earlier tonight. But we're still looking to see who's going to come through the lower point of the bracket. And, well, we're down to a couple of great teams as well. Haven't got a result yet for Complexity and 4ASC, so we probably will be them. But stay tuned. We'll be back here in a couple of moments' time for our last match of the night and our last quarterfinal.